OSPF is probably the most widely deployed IGP in existence today. You see it in every type of environment that there is. Data center, service provider, enterprise. Why is that? It's because OSPF can do so much. So what we're going to talk about in this nugget is what makes OSPF so special. What are the design implications that make OSPF a very scalable and robust and secure routing protocol to choose? And this is really setting up the topic about what are the advanced features of OSPF and where do they occur within a well-designed topology. Let's get going talking about what makes OSPF so special. This hierarchical nature is what we're really talking about. A hierarchical routing protocol, what does that even mean? And this is what we are exploring in this particular nugget. You can see here on the screen, we have area zero. Area zero is a big deal. We know this in OSPF because if we have more than one area at all, OSPF, the RFC itself, the protocol itself, dictates that we must have area zero. And understanding why we have to have this is a big deal. The idea here is that we want to break out OSPF into smaller and smaller pieces because of that pesky LSDB, the link state database. You see, when we have a really, 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 really large enterprise or service provider or data center, and therefore we have a lot of prefixes, maybe thousands of prefixes. If we only had one area, the link state database would grow and grow and grow and grow, and then all of those thousands of prefixes would contain all of that minute data. Those type 1 and type 2 LSAs would all be contained in this gigantic topology. So what we can do is we can start breaking OSPF down into smaller pieces, into different areas. And we talk about this design concept a little bit more when we start talking about area types and scaling OSPF and why we want to do that. And we're going to reiterate some of it here in this particular nugget right now. You see, when we have area 1, we have LSAs type 1 and 2 flowing throughout area 1, and they contain a lot more data than type 3 LSAs. That's why when it gets to the area border router, right here we see it's VMX2, that type 1 and type 2 LSA information gets summarized as it exits out of the area and into a different area. So the key term we want to keep in mind here is the area border router. And what we're really talking about here, when we talk about the area border router, is this is where the advanced OSPF action takes place. You see, if we had multiple routers throughout area 1 here, we can't alter what goes on in that link state database. We know that by the rule, the link state database within an area for each router has to be identical. So if VMX6 here has a type 1 LSA, then all of the other routers that participate in area 1 have to have that exact same type 1 LSA. That way they can agree on what routes are best routes for this particular area. But the moment they reach this area border router, this is where those LSAs can be manipulated because the link state database that exists in area 0 doesn't need to be identical to the link state database in area 1. In fact, this is a pretty big talking point. There is actually separate databases for each area. So if we have an ABR like VMX2 right here, it's participating in area 1 and area 0. It actually maintains two link state databases, one for each area, and it runs two separate shortest path first calculations, one for each area. Now we're going to get more into that SPF calculation and how it's run on each areas and how it makes decisions. We're going to get more into that in a later nugget. Right now we're talking about the hierarchical nature of OSPF, and this is really what we're setting up here, is that area 0 then becomes a transit area. Because the rule is that for an ABR to actually be an ABR, it can exist in one area, one non-backbone area, like area 2 or area 1, but it also must have an adjacency or a neighbor adjacency or an arm or a link in area 0. The idea here is that area 0 becomes our transit area. It is the backbone because it is what exists in order to get traffic from one area to another area. It has to pass through area 0. So if I had more areas up here and more areas over here and more areas over here, they would have to connect into area 0. It is a rule that we cannot have an area like this. Do you see how we've got, maybe this is area 3, And this is area 4. Do you notice how area 4 is not connected into area 0? This cannot exist. Yes, there is a workaround for it called the virtual link. And yes, we will be covering it in a later nugget in a later set of videos on advanced OSPF configuration. Big thing that we're trying to keep in mind here is that it all comes down to scale and managing the state of our link state database. And this is where we start getting into understanding the area types and the LSAs, and that's why we're going to have refresher nuggets on the LSAs and the area types coming up. The big thing that we're keeping in mind right now is that I really want to focus in on the different types of routers and understanding where the action takes place. The action is going to take place on the area border router because we can't alter an internal router. I'm going to go ahead and write internal here. We can't alter what goes on an internal router, meaning a router that is contained only within one area. We can't alter this because this link state database on the internal router must be the exact same on all other internal routers or ABRs or ASBRs within the same area. I can't stop a route from entering the OSPF database on an internal router because then the thing that could happen here, this router here, VMX6, performs the SPF calculation and it thinks that the best path to get from point A to point B is this way, but it doesn't have all of the information available to it. So all of the other routers within the area may think it's via a different way, and it could actually introduce routing loops because not all of the routers know about all of the official paths in order to get from point A to point B. And this is what really makes OSPF a scalable and stable solution, is the fact that the link state database within an area must match. So you can't perform a whole lot of manipulation on an internal router. The ABR is where the majority of your engineering exists. Now there are a couple other router types that you need to know about. A backbone router. This is a router that exists within Area 0. This could be an ABR. This could be an internal router. Or this could even be an ASBR that maybe has a leg in BGP or RIP or ISIS or something like that. The point is that it's somehow connected into Area 0, so we should know that Area 0 routers, regardless of their role, maybe ABR, ASBR, or internal, they are known as backbone routers. Now, we've already mentioned the ASBR, and that is also going to be an important thing. This is where route redistribution takes place. And again, there's not a whole lot of manipulation that can take place unless we're manipulating routes as they come in from the external routing protocol. Once they've made their way into OSPF, we can't change how those routes get shared throughout the exact area, again, until they get to the ABR. Now, we're going to talk about how all this takes place when we get to route summarization and route filtering and how those LSAs can be really manipulated at this point. For now, what we've set up is the hierarchical nature of OSPF and refreshed our memory with the fact that Area 0 is a really, really, really important backbone area as things get transited throughout the entire topology. When it leaves one area and enters another area, that's when we can perform some sort of manipulation. Also worth pointing out is when it leaves Area 0, we can also perform some form of manipulation. Check this out. Perhaps VMX6 here shares a route over to VMX2 through Area 1. We can perform some sort of route summarization as it gets translated into a Type 3 LSA and makes its way through Area 0. But then, as it reaches this area border router here, we could perform another translation as it enters Area 2. So the point is that it's not a one-way street. It's not only being translated or manipulated as it enters Area 0. We could also perform engineering tasks as it leaves Area 0 into the other areas that could exist in our network. One of the ideas that we could have here is maybe we could summarize routes as they enter Area 0 because we want to keep the Area 0 backbone nice and clean because that's where the majority of the routes are going to exist. Or maybe we allow all of the routes to be advertised into Area 0 and then summarize them as they leave Area 0 to keep our edge routers or our branch routers, their link state databases nice and clean. There's a couple different ways that you could play this and really optimize your entire topology. So this is understanding the hierarchical nature of OSPF and how it could set up some of the advanced topics that we're about to talk about. I hope this has been informative for you, and I'd like to thank you for viewing.